So, we are here in the summer of 2009 Hong Kong. I chose this time a little bit better time to shoot the DVD. So in about half an hour, 45 minutes, I think it's starting to get dark. We're at the same temple here, the old Kung Fu temple of the Tang family. Not mistakenly with the family temple of Tang Chung Pak, which is in China. This is another Tang family, but was famous for practicing. They held exhibitions here for different Kung Fu styles, especially Hong Kun, Hungar Kung Fu, and Wing Chun. In my DVD, Past and Present, you see the explanation, and you see the exact sign that's in the interior. The temple at this time is closed, so we cannot get inside, but we shoot it at the outside, which is also nice, yeah? So this DVD is going to be about the Siunin Tao form, the little idea form of the Wing Chun system. I'm going to demonstrate and teach you a little bit the Yip Man version and another version that we teach in my association, the IWK, which is some small variations and which is a little bit more advanced. Yeah? Very important to realize is that the Siunin Tao form of the Wing Chun system is not one of the original forms. It's not a very old form. Yeah? According to latest research, probably around the time of Dr. Leung Jan, maybe even Dr. Leung Jan himself was the man who created the Siunin Tao form. I know there's many other explanations out there. For example, Sifu Benny Meng of the Wing Chun Museum claims it's the Hung Fa Yi system that made the Siunin Tao, the Cham Ki Pyo Ji, that's the origin. Yeah? But according to my research and the research of my Sifus, we don't really agree with that. But of course, it's up to the viewer. And I always say, you know, create your own reality, right? So do your research, listen to me, but don't take my word for it. If it becomes the truth for you, it will be the truth, no matter who says it. Me, Sifu Benny Meng of the Wing Chun Museum, yeah? Other researchers. Do your own research, that's always the best way. Yeah? So the Siunin Tao form I'm going to demonstrate of the Yip Man Wing Chun system is actually form I learned from Grandmaster Leung Ting. I learned also the form from Grandmaster Yip Chun and the son of Yip Man, right? But I think this is one of the nicest versions. Yeah? But also, when you do your research, you find many different versions of Siunin Tao out there. If you go to China now in Fatsan, you find again different variations. Yeah? So don't get stuck to form. The first step of learning is form. Yeah? And we have to choose a form that suits us, that we feel good about. But don't get stuck. Oh, this is the authentic Siunin Tao form. Yeah? It's made by people, and all through generations, different kind of masters and grandmasters change the forms. But what is for sure, again I repeat, is that the Siunin Tao form is not very, very old form. Yeah? If you look at the Wing Chun Kun form, or if you look at the Chong Kun form of the Sun Kung Chong Kun form, they are much, much older. Yeah? So, and another thing is a very, very simple form. Yeah? Some lineages, they say it's the Siulin Tao, and Lin form means very simple form, which in which the movements are repeated on the left side and the right side. Yeah? So there's not too much body movements going on. But I think it's important. Many people ask me about why I don't release basic stuff. Yeah? Due to request, here it is. Okay. So there basically is two stances, basic stances in the Wing Chun system, right? So we have the Yi Gi Kim Myung Ma, or the literal translation is something like holding a goat between the leg stance, right? But in the Leung Ting system, right, I got explained it's also known as the character two adduction stance. And why the character two adduction stance? It's because the character two in Chinese is one long stripe and then a small stripe above it. So if you look at my feet there, yeah, and you go in this stance, actually here we have the small stripe, and at the end of my foot we have the long stripe, right? So they say the character two adduction stance. Now, because it's also a very big part of it is like a health form, right? We lock the hips and put the pressure, the knee pressure, not only like that, the linking force, the knee linking force, but we put it also in front, yeah? In front. So we can concentrate later on really on the breathing. Yeah? This is also the very basic stance to train the legs and the adduction muscles, right? The other stance that the other lineages of Wing Chun have, and some even have both, yeah? If you see, for example, Pak Chung lineage, Pak Chung was also a student of Tang Yik. The Tang family, actually, this is also is a student of, some say he's a student of Tang Sun, but was a student of, most of his teachings came from Tang Yik. Is they do it in the character to adduction stance and in the Keilung Ma, which is the dragon riding stance. You are like this, yeah? Just different variations, that you're exactly close to the shoulders and you have the dragon riding stance. Yeah? If you see, even also in the Yi Gi Kim Yung Ma, some, you see older photos, for example, of Sifu Gong Chun Leung, student of Yip, you see very, very, very large. Yeah? Now, some do it more small, okay? Different explanations to why and how, okay? For me, is the thing is, just do it in most natural way. Yeah, don't do it too wide, don't do it too close. Except if you do it very wide and very low, you train more your stance, yeah? And more your muscles, but it's less effective for fighting. But in my opinion, this form is not even for fighting, yeah? Just to teach you some basic movements of the Wing Chun system. So, let's set it up with the character to adduction stance, right? So, we have the character to adduction stance. Pull your hands back, right? And we have the double Tanzhao motion, or Sun Tanzhao, right? From here, you go the double Gansao motion, and then you do perform the Quansao motion, and you pull the hands back. Yeah, that's the Yip Man version, right? Now I'm not talking yet about body motos and stuff, but let's put it in there immediately. Yeah, I think it's a good idea. So one of the head is one of the motos of the stances. Lifting up the sky, standing firm to the ground, yeah? Which means really that your head, if you have the tension, your head should really push up, lift up, yeah? Then we have another one. And that you really stay focused, stay tense, concentrated on the leg muscles. The other one is head up with horizontal vision. So you pull your head back, look straight up, yeah? For example, the Yip Man system, they say when a fist comes, for example, right? You're always used to doing form like this, you get punched easier, right? So when you punch, and your head is back, you're used to getting holding your head back. There's more distance between his attack and the one launching the fist. Yeah? So we have some sounds here, some workers doing some street work. Yeah? So sorry about that. But anyway, important is when we do the Tanzhao, yeah, do it from the side, you should put your back muscle a little bit into it. From the elbow you should fold a little bit, you see? So, and there's where the power comes from. So don't keep standing like that, really go in. Then you also have the force to exert when you do the Gansao, right? So you can go like a small wave. Yeah? Don't do this, please. Like, yeah, because when you do it in application, you stay up, the other one just pushes you over, right? So always is a this kind of motion. Huh? Go in, out in. And important is do it with the cutting side of the arm, right? And let's take a small break, 2 second break because of the car. So was saying, yeah, the Ganso is an attacking motion, a hacking attacking motion. Just don't go just down on the vertical midline. Really blast it out, yeah? So really do it like, boom, you see? Boom. That's it. See, and then you have like a hollow chest. Hollow chest. That will make more space between you and the attacker. Plexus. Finish. Hide the plexus. Create more space. Okay? Now, in some other variations, right, from forms I saw in China, found some very interesting things. Yeah? So the form, how I teach it in my international headquarters in Amsterdam and my affiliated schools. So we add the motion, yeah? And we'll give you that also immediately. Boom, boom, Wanzhou, Sun, Danzhou, then forward, push, pull. And then with the last three fingers, you do a grabbing motion, a grabbing motion. And you pull the hand back. Yeah? So in the Yip Man version, you really pull the hand straight back. Say Sao Cheng of Hao Zhan. Yeah, like really like a backward elbow strike. That's also the application, yeah? Like backward elbow strike. The other one is more pulling motion. And returning the hands. Okay? Now, the second one. In the Yip Man system, right? The fist is thrust out and all the force goes out and it stays there. Mm-hmm. So put the fist for your chest and whoop, out. Open, Danzhou. Keep the arm stretched, keep the elbow immovable. Pull the hand back and you turn. Fist. Back. Put the fist. And when you put the fist, look at the body again. You pull your. See? Again, go down. And then you can exert the force. Open. Turn. Back. Yeah? One more time. Pull in. Boom. Open. And back. So that's really Siun and Tao, really very little idea. Actually, for real fighting situation, it is not really good to just exert force. Yeah, nobody does a punch like this and stays there, right? A fist is going out and pulled back. So in China, many different variations, right? Of this form. So in my headquarters, I teach this as a beginning way for people who never punch, just to learn how to exert force. But then we add the heaven man theory that the fist should always cover heaven and man, and we use push pull. So, when you only exert force, people can make use of it, right? Maybe pull your arm or put you in an arm lock or whatever. But what comes out must come back, right? So I teach it like this. You see, I exert the force and I pull it back. So it's a push-pull. Or when an opponent stops my fist, I can immediately pull it and attack again, so he can get rid of his arm. Yeah? So we add a push-pull feature. If you want to put more concepts and more principles into it, you can add the boot cue or the tu cue bridging concepts, right? So you have the control from the outside to the inside, which would be this angle, or you have the control from the inside to the outside, which would be this angle, and then you add the spiral motion, yeah, the twisting motion, which is very unique and significant in Wing Chun, the spiraling motion. And if you shoot an arrow or you shoot a bullet, the arrow don't come out straight or the bullet doesn't come out straight, always have this swirling motion. To increase power and increase chances of penetration into the opponent's defenses. Then, one time I saw, right, let's see the Ip Man one, open. You see the end like this. They don't end like this. So for some angles, we also have the horizontal fist. Not in the Ip Man system. Again, the Ip Man system, thrust out, open, and that's it. But the horizontal fist in some situations, very important. In the Ip Man system, we find fist like this, yeah, something similar when we have the BG form, right? So it's a very, very good idea to train it like this. That's how we do it, right? So we punch, same position like the Tanzo, open. You see, you put a little bit of an angle. Back, put it, open, your position of the Tanzo. You see, I shift the weight, I sink and I shift the weight, yeah? We call this the Yang punch, yeah? So we have a Yin force, Yin punch, and Yang punch, yeah? And back. Okay, now the third section is called Sampai Fat. Actually, there is also a Wing Chun form that's called Sampai Fat, so don't get confused. Yeah? But this section, Sampai Fat, means three times praying to the Buddha, right? So some lineages say, okay, one for the Tanzhao. And three times, actually the Wusa position is the praying. Yeah, the praying position of the monks in the ancient times. So in some lineages they say one for the Tanzhao and then now three for the Buddha. So you do the Fu and the Wu another three times. Okay, now other lineages again do it just three times. They forget to count. They add also the count from the first one. Yeah, so they don't say one for the Tanzhao and three for the Buddha. They immediately do three for the Buddha, right? So what's important is to perform normally. This is the part that's linked to the Qigong. We also have an ancient Sinam Tao form derived from old manuscripts, which is really a breathing form and only for health. But this part you can isolate and just do for Qigong. So actually, from here till the end of your Tanzhao could take like half an hour if you do it with the right breathing. Now, of course, I'm not going to do that now to put it on this DVD, but I will explain you a little bit. Yeah? So a different kind of breathing. I will explain you for this DVD the simplest one. Yeah? Is you go breathe in with your nose, not like this, like it closes, but behind. You put your tongue on your palate so that the chi can flow, and then you go from behind, this kind of breathing, yeah, you breathe in like that for about 1 minute, whatever it takes, yeah, to fill up your stomach. Yeah, so you're flat and then you go. Yeah, so you slowly filling it with air, and then you breathe out with the letter A. Yeah, you push the air out maximum, and you pull in your stomach like that. You're also massaging your internal organs. So let's make a small break again because of the car. Otherwise, you make problem hearing me. Cool. Yeah, it's getting pretty hot here. Even though it's late, yeah, it's about 40 degrees, a lot of humidity. So my tempo is a little bit slower than when we shoot the DVDs in Europe. Yeah? I hope you have the patience. Anyway, the third part. So, told you it can take an hour, right? Okay, take at least half an hour. You concentrate on the longest finger, right? And really, like, you imagine also, you have to use your mind power, that you put the energy from all around you through the hand and into your system. When you do it good, when the hand comes out, you do it with a good breathing, the hand becomes red, later purple, and you get all these spots. And some call it like the black hand. You find it also in some karate styles, and they have the same thing. It's just qigong training, very good for health. Yeah? So I will not do it in as slow as it needs to be, but just for the explanation, otherwise the DVD will take hours. Eh? You go very slow. Normally the hand should move, but you should not even notice it moving. That's how slow you should do it, yeah? But then when you have the tassel, so I go, again, I go much quicker than normal, yeah? Much quicker than normal. You should have three ways of force from the elbow. The elbow should push inwards, outwards, and you should have the lock box in chamjan, the sinking elbow and dropping shoulder, very important. And then when you put these three ways of force, your hand starts to shake. Yeah, your hand starts to shake. And then you do it with the breathing. So you have the, I do it now also quicker, the breathing. Normally 1 minute in, 1 minute out. We do it a little bit faster, right? So you do. Yeah? You should do it like that. So we have the tansao. Remember the three ways of force: in, out, and forward. And we do the wuzao. Hunsao, wuzao. Now at this moment, when it is totally frontal, the wuzao should be on this nipple. And we have the vertical midline, the earth line. We have the nipple line, is man, your human line. And then we have your shoulder, is the heaven line, right? So I try to go on the earth line, does not go, of course, in. That's why, because of the pressure, the tension was shaking. And do the hyun, and now it's on the man, human line. Now, when you pull it back, never bend this. Never bend this. You keep this angle, you pull back from your elbow, and then the hand slowly moves to the earth line. And now it's on the, exactly on the center, on the vertical midline. The center line runs here, so your wuzao should be, your hand should be above the center line, otherwise you're open. So don't do this too low, because people will hit, right? So also don't keep the hand like that, because you have a bridge that goes over it. Pull the hand really back, that in order to hit you, he has to do two motions. He goes in to lift the arm and then go over it, right? So really have the praying angle. Yeah, so from the side, right, you're here, you pull it back like this, cluck, that's it. This is the wuzao. Okay? Then you drop the hand, and then you put the pressure on again. So now the hand is relaxed, put the pressure on the wrist, put the hand down, that the bicep relaxes. If you notice, the bicep is relaxed, not tensed. Yeah? And then you put the pressure again, inside, forward, and downward. And you have it again. Your shaking hand with the breathing normally. And then you do it again. Back, drop the hand again, and go forward again. And don't go too high, you'll create an opening. Do it like here. Hand relaxed, fingers point down. The bicep relax. If you put the hands up, the bicep becomes tense. And it's not good for your qigong training. Yeah, the hand is down. The pressure is on the wrist. And the three ways of force. Yeah? This is good training. And you can train this underarm muscle, you see? You get here like a Popeye arm from this. And it's very, very good training. Okay, when you are back, yeah, so very important, eh? The dropping shoulder, sinking elbow. that when you are here and your arm, let's say your arm gets jammed, your elbow connects with your hip bone. There was no opening between. Yeah? And you are back in the Ip Man form. Paksa to your shoulder, back to the middle, and thrust out with the palm swipe. Open it, turn, and back. So, if you do it, this again the basic way, and this is how the Ip Man form does it, and we teach it again in the little bit more advanced way after a while in our headquarters, in our association. So we add again the heaven and human theory and the push-pull, the two heights. So we add some life to it, and then we have push-pull. Yeah? Okay, so push-pull. Instead of just leaving it there and only exerting the force. Now, the fourth set is more like an aerobic type of exercise. Yeah? It's more of how you exert force and to help get the elastic ging force, you know, in China also the fogging, the explosive force, right? So we're doing more like an aerobic exercise. So you immediately go down in the Ip Man system, you immediately go down, right? And then, and there's a small shoulder hit there. If you see, most people don't notice that, but a little bit left side, a little bit right side, you go down, and then you go right side, yeah, this is the shoulder hit. And you go behind, and here, it's like this, right? And you thrust it out like this, right? Like here, and then you do this. Forward and again, you see the work of the body. Yeah, you shoot it out, and then this is the Gamsa motion. Then you do long. You really stop it, block it, lock the force. It's very important to lock it now in an upward way. Yeah? Maybe we should get Sihin Maurik out here now. Maybe to demonstrate the type of force, yeah, that the Lanza motion should have. You can get Sihin Maurik out here, one of my students from the headquarters, to show you. Yeah? So look, if you have the double Lanza motion, look at the back. You see the back muscles. This would be wrong. Now look at the look here. Yeah, what happens is this is it. So you get a hunchback, and you twist your arms and make the force go upward. Line. So we have it's called bar arm, right? So you can put something between you and the opponent, and also create space with it. So it needs to be a very stable position. If you just do it like that, and somebody pushes you, you're going to flip over, right? It's going to turn over. So if he gives. If I do it like this and I do it wrong and he pushes, right? But if I do it in a good way, I can even put one arm, right? And maybe you put your leg back, right? So, and I put it upward. And when he pushes now, yeah, so his force goes down. Yeah? And then you can even put it like this, one leg and pushes, a little bit down, a little bit force more to me, elbows deeper. You can put more force, yeah, and push harder, right? So I can put his force into the floor, right? So the way how you perform the motions in the form is very important. Yeah? Just don't put your hands like that, yeah? You have to put the principle, the concept of the motion inside it to make it alive. It's starting to rain out here, so let's take a small break. Okay, because of it started to rain, we switched locations. So we're here now in a small alley in the village in China. So maybe nice scenery, right?
People who never been to Chinese villages, it's all very small, yeah?
Maybe you could take the inside of a house, right?
Try. Okay, so.
Just for the people who say, okay, this guy never was in China, he films it in Amsterdam by some Chinese in Chinatown. And you see, we're really there. Anyway, we have the distance here. Oops, so we sometimes we shoot it in an angle. So we have the Lanzhou. Now comes the Faxo, yeah? So want you to understand that this force is maximum force, yeah? So you put it out. Don't forget the small sideward bend for the shoulder strike. Maximum force, yeah? So you really should maybe come the camera a little bit closer. You hear the force, right? If you put it, it's really the elastic force. Then you lock it up with the line, and then you get the same thing, yeah? You bend, and now you shoot out. All the power thrust out. Boom! With the Faxo. Like two rattan canes being released. Boom! Yeah. Boom! And again, all these exercises, you can isolate and make it into an aerobic exercise. Yeah? In order to get proficient with the Faxo, to get power from it, elastic power, you should practice it at least thousands of times. So if you do all the time the form just once or twice or three times even, you have three times Faxo training in a day. So better to do it as aerobic exercise. One, two, three, four. All the motions you want to get good at, just isolate them and put them into an aerobic kind of exercise. So, when you thrust out the Faxo, you come back, right hand on top, and then we get for the first time medium force. So you do chums out, the sinking elbow. And look again at the back, right? And the pressure is in, out, and downward again. So just don't put your hand like that. Think of the pressure in, downward, and outward. Okay? Turn your hands, again, medium force. The toxa motion, medium force. And you turn your hands, now you get a jutsu. The jutsu means the shocking hand. So you put, now again, maximum force into that. So we had max, 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 lock up, max, medium, medium for the toxa. And now max with the jutsu. So make two hooks from your hands a little bit, and you do even your legs join the program. So you go down and you do. Put really maximum force into it, and then at the same time shoot up again. So with the bujisan, and it's like the young bujisan. So we have this. This meridian line, right? We put it in. Put the thumb like that. But you can hit with thrust with the fingers in the eye. And you can also thrust with the thumb in the eye. Right? So we have jutsu, and the bujisan. Then you do the kamsan, and you do the tisan. And back. So, bujisan. Long bridge comes out, tees out, and back. And that's for the Yip Man version of the form. Now again, give you some, a little bit more sophisticated, a little bit more advanced version that we train at my headquarters from accumulated knowledge I got from China to repeat these kind of things because it's so many strange males sometimes. So, actually, do all the same. Except this one, we can put also a double fist. So instead of doing the gamsan, seon gamsan, in front of the body, you put a double fist there. Right? Small variation. Now, when you put the double lanza, you make more clear push-pull motion. And we can put it into an application like a takedown, right? So the right arm makes a pulling motion and the left arm makes a pushing motion. Same end position. Then, Faxau, same thing. Now again, right arm makes the pull, left arm makes the push. Chum Zhao, same thing. Tok Zhao, same thing. Jet Zhao, same thing. QG Zhao, same thing. Now, only when you do the long bridge Gam Zhao, you don't lock your shoulder out like in the Yip Man version. You make it more round. You make more like a ball, like a circle. That I don't restrict myself, only possibility is going up. But from here, I can go up and I can go round. I can even change it into a hooking punch if I want. Then, from this round motion, I go up, I pull, empty chest, and I make a back fist. And I go back. So it's just actually a very small variation. It's not too much to get very excited over. So the fifth one, the Yip Man system, right? So we're back. One, put it to your shoulder, turn it, boom, go to the middle like this, and you shoot out, bam, and back. It's a very simple one, yeah? Pop, back, bam. Actually, it's three palm strikes, right? We have the upward one, the middle one, and the reversed one, yeah? So, let me explain this part now. In our form, sometimes the headquarters, we also incorporate the turning stance. So when we have the turning stance, right, we have the Yigi Kimuma, we can also train the turning stance at the same time. So for example, by the fifth, it would be, right? Now, if we go also the other side, it would be, and then we incorporate also the push-pull. So, push-pull. Right, just to make it more sophisticated, the form, yeah? So all ideas and things I saw in China from the different lineages and accumulated into the bad one. Because so many of my clients, my buyers of my DVDs are really focus on the Yip Man system. I make this DVD a Yip Man Simmental DVD and give you the extras in there so you can improve on it or add some knowledge, right? And same with my students at the headquarters in Amsterdam, for example, or my students all around in my association can also benefit from it because they see, okay, this is how the Yip Man system does it and this is how we train it in our student programs. So I catch two flies at the same time. Now, the sixth, let's go into the sixth. Yeah, the fifth again, very like an aerobic exercise. Yeah? The sixth, put your tanzo out, same like the third, yeah, but much quicker, of course. Then you sink the chamzao, the sinking elbow, and again, keep in mind the three lines. Yeah? So we have the hand, which is on the earth line. We have the elbow, which is on the human line, and the shoulder, which is like the heaven line. With the chum zao motion, yeah? From the side, and you go out, and then you sink it. Sinking elbow. So you have one fist length. And again, look at the back again, yeah? And now, when you have the chum zao, make sure the center line, yeah, is covered. So always one piece of the arm is above the center line, one piece of the arm is under the center line. One fist length, never go beyond one fist length, would be wrong. So, one fist length, and have the tension now. When the chamzao is there, you are in, downward, and forwards again. And you put the elbow out, on the shoulder line, and on the heaven line, and you do the guazao motion. Boom. So again, cham, guazao. Open it,
bend it a little bit, stop, and now lift it up from the elbow. Till here. Schön so. Lower palm strike. Open. Schön so. Shaojun or Haojian. Right? Chan is elbow, so Haojian is backward elbow strike. Shaojun just means retrieval of the hand. Some lineage again. We made some variations also in my teachings. They do it like this. Up. They do instead of a Hun Sao, they do more of a Hun God. And then they do a lower strike with the Q Sao. And the Q Sao is the bridge part of the arm, right? And if you want to incorporate the turning stance, this is again also a possibility. Yeah? So you do the Cham Sao, you do the Guat Sao, you do the Lao Sao, the Hun God, you do the turning stance, and then you do a small turning stance the other side. And back. But again, for the Yip Man people, Guat, Hun, lower palm strike. And that applies only for the Yip Man people who do the Lung Ting system. If you have other kind of lineages, yeah? For example, I'll give you a better example. In the old days, Grandmaster Yip Man taught it without the Cham Sao. He went from the Tan, immediately to the Guat, and then up. Or some say even from the Tan to the Gan, and then up. And then Hun. Right? And that there's a story, the Wong Chun Lung people, they say the story that Wong Chun Lung got into a fight with a southern praying mantis guy, went very low, and then in the fight hit him on the stomach. So Yip Man, because of that, Yip Man incorporated the Cham Sao motion into the sixth set of the form. I think it's a very basic story. I don't know the significance of this story. Eh? It's all a little bit, not so important, I think. Eh? What's important is just movements, and the more movements are in there, the better it is to train your body and system, right? I could make a whole new cinematography form if I wanted. But just to make clear, first step of learning is form. So we get stuck in form in the beginning to perfect the movements and to really get it into our nervous system, right? So we keep it in the Lung Ting way now for the Yip Man system. Tan, Cham, Guat, Lao Sao, Hun, lower palm strike, and back. Okay? Or for the people from the IWK, we also have this version, right? What? Turning stance, and back. So that concludes the sixth. So now we get to the seventh, which is the Bong Sao. Now, from the Wing Chun Kun form, we know that the Bong Sao, and also the theory, we know that the Bong Sao should never be higher, right? This is Bong Sao in Wing Chun. When it goes higher than this, it becomes a Tan Sao. Otherwise, you're open. We don't have this Bong Sao, like some lineages do in the original system, yeah? But some, they do it like this, right? And even on the footage of Grandmaster Yip Man, you see this. So there's also many stories I've heard, interviewed people in China that said, okay, later on after Dai Da Clan, they corrected his Bong Sao and he changed it and stuff, yeah? Now, after the Bong Sao, we have the reverse palm strike. Same story applies there. He did it very high, but the application is actually very low. This low palm strike is for the groin area. Yeah, to hit high, it's better to do this fist, to do a Chan Sao, to do a normal palm strike, or even sideways palm strike, but not the reverse one. Obviously, the reverse one is really to attack the groin area. Yeah, but anyway, you can train it higher to train the muscles that it becomes stronger for the lower area. But for now, I demonstrate it low, okay? So the Bong Sao, you just shoot out, boom, and make sure that you have the heaven line, that the elbow is on the human line, the earth line is here, so not on the wrist, because the wrist is on this human line, and then the hand, fingertips are on this heaven line. This is the correct angle for the bongsan, and this is the height that should be in application, and not higher than this, because then it gets under, right? So in the Vinchen Kun form, for example, we have bong, and then from here, it switches now. Yeah, it switches now. Just finish the set, otherwise it looks so stupid, right? So this should be the height. Now, you sink in the body, yeah, when you have the tanza. Then put the palm down, then lift the elbow up and lift your back up. That's where the attack should go, to the groin area. But that's the seven, yeah? Boom, boom, down, and up. Conclude seven. Now, eight. So, you cut this part of the arm, cutting motion. Put this one, the tanza, the right arm, in the same position as the first section. Now you do the tutsa motion, the freeing hand motion. Don't do this like many people do. Just cut that direction. And it's a push-pull. This hand, right hand, and the right hand pushes, the left hand pulls, yeah? So we get this one. Yeah? This is the action. Yeah? With your, like you're sawing off your own hand. From there, we make three chain punches. Again, in the Yip Man system, just thrust out in a straight line. One, two, three. Yeah? One, two, three. One, two, three. Yeah? So, one, two, three. One, two, three. You end with the left hand. Open. Finish it off. If you want to do it a little bit more advanced, you put again the concepts into it, which is the heaven, human theory, cover the two heights, and you put the push-pull into it. Remember, I explained the story that when you only push and thrust out the force, they can make use of it. And when you just push out and you get stuck, you're done. And when you put the push-pull motion into it, you get rid of the opponent's arm and you can go again. It's like a wave, like a circling motion, more natural. So, the Yip Man version, one, two, three, one, two, three, open. And better would be, yeah, so, yeah, this is the circular motion. And so you push, pull, and you end it like that. So, this concludes this DVD for the Siam Tao. I think it was very valuable for the people of the Yip Man lineage in my association and outside of my association, and also for the people who do the Siulan lineage, where I also teach the Siulan Tao form as a little idea form, but with influences and knowledge I received all through my years of going to China and research. Yeah, so we have this special Siam Tao form, we teach at the headquarters. So I think it's a very valuable DVD for everybody. And actually, this is part one, disc one. Now, if you open the box, you notice that there is also a part two. And the part two is like a 20-minute DVD, which has some applications, yeah, to make the form more clear. Because if you train the form in the beginning, it's really important that when you do a gansao, and that you notice, okay, what it is for, that you really know what you're doing there, okay? So that you have the application in mind with it. Okay? And the applications can be numerous. I just give you some examples of what is possible with some of the motions. Okay, thank you for watching, and see you in part two. Before we conclude also, forgot it actually, it should be part of
the piece we filmed there, is there's some more mottos there, right? So we have the containable chest, elevated back, right? So I think more importantly, we should say the hamhung, the empty chest, and the logbook, dropping shoulders we talked about, that we have always a space, yeah, protection, and always a space to exert force and come back, like the wave. Right? Some say containable chest, elevated back. But if you have my other DVDs where I explain hamhung, logbook, cham jan, su cheng, exposed to the sun, it's already enough. Yeah? Just to put you full with mottos, yeah? It's too much. Then we have also, this is more important, we have a saying that says the eye should follow the hand, which is true. Yeah? If you do the third, the eye should follow the hand. When you go to the paksa, the eye should follow the hand. It just makes you more sharp, more focused. And when you're in a fighting situation, for example, and the guy just goes to the other side, that you immediately react because your eyes is very trained, you know, in all directions. Yeah? Also, yeah, I explained about the two stands, right? The Yigi Kimyongma and the Keilungma. Now, if we train the Silum Tao form in the Keilungma, in the Yipman version, everything stays the same. But if we do it like I add the turning stance, so the shifting of the weight, and notice my word, the turning stance means the stance that turns is actually more a weight shifting process. Yeah? Then it becomes a little bit more complicated, right? So because in the Yip Man system, right, it's very clear that we cover always the center line, so we keep always on the middle. We never do something like this because you open up. So if you add in the Yigi Kimyongma turning stance, it's very clear that it still protects because you're just changing angles. But if you do it in the Keilungma, notice some of the students were starting and beginning, let's say the third one as an example, yeah, let's take this one. It was starting to do up and then, for example, shift the weight and then went to the side. And when you push the arm of the opponent to the side, you open up your center line, yeah, right? So, seeing Maori comes again, a little bit small street, but Wing Chun is made for small areas, I say, right? So, if I would do this, for example, let's take it with this hand there, and I would just go all out here, I would open up here, right? Or if I'm here, I open it up, I'm open here, right? So, important is, when you do it with the Keilungma also, it's just a shift of the weight, but the hand really don't move so much, yeah? So if I go to this side, boom, and if I go to inside and I go to the other side, look, the hand stays, I just shift the body, and I'm still in this line. So I never do, yeah, so if you notice, from the Keilungma, I do shift of the weight, shift of the weight, but the hand never moves, right? For the Yip Man Wing Chun people, it's more easy to see when you're in the turning stance. Already from your chisao, two men sets or chisao sections, you see it, right? So when I have a palm strike, for example, right? I have a palm strike. No, just keep your fist. Just be a dummy, right? So I just do the turning stance. And while turning, the center line faces the shoulder. So center line faces my shoulder. And can go in, right? Through the hand, through the shoulder. Very important, don't go outside. So, Yip Man, palm, you see, fu. And with the turning stance and the push-pull action, you do. In the Yigi Kimyongma, you do whoop, whoop. And in the Keilungma, we just shift the weight, whoop, whoop. Crucial. Just to make it clear when you practice. Thought it was important, so that's why I came back. Okay, see you next time.